You hear me? You guys hear me? There we go. There's a video or audio for it. For those of you who weren't aware, I did the keynote at Riga Dev Days 4 years ago. And fortunately, this time I get to do it without breaking my shoulder. No, true story. Actually, the night before the keynote, I was walking through a parking lot in Riga and slipped on some black ice and broke my shoulder. And Dimitri took me on a lovely tour of all of the various Riga medical facilities. And Andre helped me discover something very important about shoulders, that you actually need both of them to button your pants. So Andre had to supply the other shoulder. He's still in therapy, trying to forget that. So thank you for that, again, Andre. Yeah, I want to talk about heroes and epic soundtrack right there. How many people in this room have architect somewhere in their title? Show of hands. A few of you, not a lot of you. How many of you want to be an architect at some point in your life? Show of hands. Okay, that's maybe a third of the room total that has raised their hands. The rest of you, why are you still here? I mean, seriously, if you're not an architect and you don't want to be an architect, why do you care? I was doing this talk at one point a couple of years ago, and somebody from the back shouted, because I want to finally figure out what the architect actually does. That's fair. The interesting thing about architecture is that if you talk to a number of speakers and other folks, they will tell you that architect is actually an ancient Latin word that stands for cannot code anymore. There's some truth to that, perhaps. Architecture actually does serve a useful purpose. And I want to get to what that purpose is, besides, by the way, providing a place for programmers to retire, or this is the last stop before programmers go to die. It's kind of like, you know, the elephant's graveyard. When the elephant knows that it's about ready to croak, it crawls off to some distance away from the herd, lays down and dies. Programmers just get promoted to architect, and then they crawl off in the distance and die. Good times. What I want to do with this particular discussion is I want to talk at a fairly high level as to what architecture is. Because unfortunately, it's one of those things that we haven't really come to a unified agreement as to what things mean. When you say to people, I'm a software developer, I'm a programmer, people have a pretty good idea of what it is you do. You come in to work in the morning, you set your bag down, you grab some coffee, maybe you go look at the backlog, maybe you've already figured out what you're doing, you sit down and you put on your headphones and you kind of disappear into the machine for like 6 hours. Or at least that's what you're supposed to do. The problem is the program manager comes over, starts asking you questions. The web designer asks you some questions. Your buddy, who's really, really big into soccer, football, comes over and says, did you see the game last night? But for the most part, this is pretty much what everybody's programmer's days looked like. Regardless of whether you write Java, .NET, JavaScript, Go, Haskell, or God help us all, Perl. Your day looks pretty much the same. If you're an architect, what does your day look like? Meetings, meetings, Visio, PowerPoint, meetings, meetings, email, meetings, Visio, PowerPoint, PowerPoint, Visio, meetings, email. What exactly are you doing with all of that time? The other thing I want to do, though, is I want to make sure that we keep to a very, very pragmatic perspective. Because very bluntly, it's very easy for people coming up here to talk about architecture in very, very highfalutin terms. To use very big words, to use some really, really majestic hand-waving, and ultimately tell you absolutely nothing. And we want to try to avoid that to the best of our ability. One of the important things to ask is, when exactly did it become okay to joke about architects? I mean, if you think about it, if we take pretty much any other industry, there are people who have reached levels of prestige that we respect. If you are the chief surgeon of a hospital, you've garnered a certain amount of respect. If you're the partner within a law firm, you had to earn your way to get there. That carries some respect with it. If you're the coach of a basketball team, or if you're the captain of the soccer team, you didn't just grant that, you earned that. There's respect that goes with that. You clearly have demonstrated a high level of skill in your chosen industry. And yet, when we talk about software architects, even when we talk about people from the academic world, professors and so forth, a lot of us have a tendency to go, yeah, what do they know? Really? I mean, come on, guys, like a PhD in computer science, what's he going to do? Talk to us about the language that he invented? How is that going to make my life any better? Oh, this guy's the chief architect at some company. Right, what does that really mean? He sits around, he's maybe buddies with the CTO, maybe he was there in the early stages of the company. What does that really do for us? Don't get me wrong, architects have earned that in many, many ways, but it's important to sort of call back and ask what happened. There are two blog posts I would call out. How many of you have heard of Joel Spolsky? Couple of hands. You need to read Joel Spolsky. Joel on Software is his blog title. Joel is probably one of the best humorists in the software industry alive today. Joel has spent a tremendous amount of time actually working in the trenches. As a matter of fact, when he worked at Microsoft, he worked on Excel. So if you have any bug reports for him, he's not listening to you at all. But Joel actually spent a lot of time writing software, and he's seen a lot of the evils and ills that we talk about within the industry. There are two posts in particular. The Why I Hate Frameworks post is particularly poignant for anybody who grew up in the Java world. I'll leave that one to you to discover on your own. But the other one, Architecture Astronauts. It's an interesting thing. How many people here flew commercially to get here to Riga? I know I did. Yeah, good number of you. You ever notice that when you get on board an aircraft, they tell you that in the event that the cabin loses pressure, oxygen masks will descend from the ceiling, blah, 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 blah. Usually by this point, you're on your phone, right? Whatever, keep going. Why exactly do we need those? Well, the higher up you go, the more the atmosphere thins out, the less actual usable oxygen there is in the air. And the funny thing is, when you start getting oxygen deprivation, when you start losing oxygen to your brain, some really, really weird shit begins to happen to you. You begin to make some really poor decisions. You begin to hallucinate. You begin to assume that everything is well. This is why they always tell you to put your mask on first before assisting anybody else, because if you don't get that mask on, you may decide that you're actually okay and, oh, look, it's so pretty outside. I think I'll step outside. This now begins to explain a number of things, because architects routinely talk about getting the 50,000-foot view. It's clear what's happened. These architects at 50,000 feet forgot to put their mask on. And they've started to hallucinate. They've started to make poor decisions like EJB or Perl or microservices everything or serverless because somehow it doesn't have servers or the whole Java 9 module system. Let's just, you know, clearly that was just one really, really long round-the-world flight while they came up with that thing, right? The architect, I took a poll of a number of friends of mine who are architects, who teach architecture classes. I said, what do you guys think architects are? And this is the list that they came up with. Yeah. I like that last one. No real idea what they're doing and still has management completely fooled. How many of you know one of those architects? Show of hands. How many of you are one of those architects? Put your hands down, idiots. Jeez, God, so easy to get them sometimes. Let me ask you this question. You see those two buildings up there, right? If I were to ask you, are these two buildings the same? Most of you would probably say no. I mean, yeah, they're buildings, right? They have walls, they have a ceiling, they have a floor. Yeah, in that sense, they're the same. But for the most part, I mean, one of them you throw together using some lumber from the scrap bin down at the local lumber yard. You can do it in a weekend. The other one clearly requires a whole slew of efforts that the first one does not. Now, the funny thing is, if I were to bring your manager, your users, anybody that's not a developer into the room, and I were to show them these two projects, and I were to say, hey, do you think these two are the same project? Could they be built the same way? Most people, let's be blunt, even though your users may be the dumbest users ever, most people would look at those two buildings and say, yeah, no, they get constructed differently. They behave differently. The way in which we build these things is different. One is obviously something we can throw together over a weekend. The other one requires years and years of planning and execution, et cetera. And yet, every software developer knows this story, even if they haven't lived it. One day you're in your office or you're in your cubicle and your boss comes in and says, hey, we need to throw together a prototype for marketing. They need a quick thing thrown together. They need a quick thing, you know, by the end of the week. So you say, sure, boss, I can do that. I'll, maybe grab some Spring Boot and maybe some Vue.js and, a little Bootstrap to make it look pretty. We'll mock out everything. It has no logic whatsoever. There's no data storage. It's all completely faked. And by the end of the week, your boss comes in and says, hey, where are you at? And I say, oh, yeah, here, let me show you. Work this up. And the boys from marketing are with him there in the office. And they get this light in your eyes, and suddenly you can see what's happening next, but you can't stop it. You're like an action star in a movie moving in slow motion. As your boss says, ship it. And you're like, but hang on, boss. Project Doghouse is not ready to ship. He's like, no, I look at it, it's great. You need to stop with the imposter syndrome. This looks really good. We need to ship this. This was amazing work. You might actually get a promotion someday if you keep doing work like this. This is amazing. And you're like, but you're on Project Doghouse now. And so you work on it, you're desperately trying to pay off the technical debt, and finally you go to your boss and you say, hey boss, no, look, this has been fun, but I'm done. Project Doghouse, I'm finished, I want out. Your boss says, no. Project Doghouse is a mission-critical application. And we can't let you transfer it to a different part of the company. So you're like, that's it. I quit. You go work at another company across town, and one day you're hanging out with somebody, and they're like, wait a minute. I know you. You did Project Doghouse, right, for that other company. And you're like, ah. And so you leave, and you fly, and you get a job in Seattle. And you're working there, and one day you're online, and suddenly you get a LinkedIn request from somebody who's saying, didn't you work on Project Doghouse? And you're like, Mars, Elon Musk, come save me, ship me to Mars. So everybody knows that story, the prototype that got shipped to production. It's like one of our legends, right? When the programmers sit around the campfire, which of course is a virtual campfire because we would never be caught dead in the woods. When the programmers sit around the campfire, we talk about these myths and legends and lore. We all know it. It's like a disturbance in the force, right? You can feel when a prototype gets shipped production. So when your boss comes to you and says, hey, the guys in marketing, they want to do this project, you say, oh, I know how this story goes. Sure, boss, sure. I'll get your week-long project started. Yeah, no problem. So the boss comes to you at the end of the week. The boss says, hey, how's that project going? And you say, boss, we are making amazing progress. We have almost finished iteration zero, where we have selected the tools, the various places we're going to host the code. We've almost figured out which cloud system we're going to host this thing in. We can't quite decide yet whether we're going to do Angular or React, but we've got a couple of prototypes that we're working on to figure out which one will actually be better. We have started to spec out our epics. We're going to work on grooming the backlog, and we're thinking that Project Doghouse could probably be done somewhere in about a six-month time frame, give or take 3 months. And your boss is looking at you like, time out. This was supposed to be a prototype. No, boss. I know. You said you wanted a prototype. That's what they always say. I felt it in the force. I saw this guy with long hair talking about it on a stage. Therefore, it must actually turn out this way. You're going to want to ship this. Your boss is like, you're fired. And you're like, screw that. I quit. And you both of you walk out of the room thinking the other side is an idiot. How did we get to this point?
Seriously, look at those two buildings. We all can tell the difference between a prototype and the real thing. Why can't we do that with software? The problem actually made itself very clear to me a number of years ago. How many of you saw the movie Tron, the second one, Tron Legacy, with the older Jeff Bridges and the, yeah. There's a great piece from this entitled The Grid. I want to play it for you here real quick. There we go. Yeah.
The Grid.
Grid, loving it.
A digital frontier.
Digital frontier, I'm with you, man.
I tried to picture clusters of information as they move through the computer.
I try to picture clusters of information as they move through the computer. Yeah, man, what does that look like? Keep going.
What did they look like?
Yeah.
Ships, motorcycles. Were the circuits like freeways?
Hold on. Ships, motorcycles. Were the circuits like freeways? Suddenly, Maven makes more sense to me now. Because when you start a Maven build, it's like a whole fleet of Titanics trying to make their way through the streets of Riga, and everything just comes to a screeching bloody halt. Seriously? If we were to crack open the CPU, we won't see motorcycles or freeways. What we will see is the things that we as developers know exist: threads, objects, processes, garbage collector, right? The garbage collector in particular is this little thing that's moving around throughout the heap, which of course is over here in the corner somewhere, and it's finding these objects and picking them up and bringing them back and recycling them, right? That's what we're going to see. If we crack open the CPU, we're going to see these objects that we constantly talk about, that we constantly work with, right? No. What are we going to see? We're going to see a lot of voltage pulses going like this, really, really fast. See, that's the funny thing about software, is it's all these abstractions on top of abstractions, on top of abstractions, on top of abstractions, on top of abstractions, on top of abstractions. If I were to ask you right now to point to the software in this room, what do you point to? You make this, you give this question to anybody who's not in the industry, and they will immediately point to the screen. They will point to the pixels, and they will say, that is the software. That is what we deal with, because we work with things that literally don't exist. No wonder people think we're nuts, because people who routinely talk about things that don't exist usually end up in a padded room somewhere. In our case, they've chosen us to give us ridiculous amounts of money. Six of one, half dozen of the other. Yeah, I'll take this, thank you very much. The problem is software is so ephemeral. And when we talk about architecture, that's another layer of abstractions on top of this already ephemeral, completely non-existent, except in the abstractions that we've created for ourselves world. What is architecture? Whenever you start asking some of these kinds of questions, it's helpful to go back to dictionary definitions. Let's work from that. This was from some online dictionary, I forget which one. Building design, art and science of designing and constructing buildings. Okay, not super helpful. That's talking about the original definition of architecture. Building style. Style or fashion of building, especially one that is typical of a period of history or of a particular place. The organizers took the speakers on a little walking speaking tour of downtown Riga, and they were constantly talking about the different architectures, the different styles, the romanticism, the various medieval styles that were present inside of Latvian architecture, et cetera, et cetera. They're very clearly speaking to this second definition. But the third one's really interesting. Structure of computer system. The design, structure, and behavior of a computer system, microprocessor, or system program. Now think about that for a second. If architecture is something that can be said to apply to chips, we often talk about the x86 architecture or the ARM architecture or the RISC architecture, but we also can talk about the structure of a program. We talk about MVC architectures, or we talk about the structure of computer systems and tier architecture. Architecture isn't just about going up one level in abstraction. It's something a little bit different. Because one level up from the CPU, we start talking about operating systems or programming languages or assembly language or something along those lines. So there's more to this architecture thing than just one level up the stack. One of the interesting exercises that frequently comes out is to say, hey, what do we expect of a good architecture? How many people here have worked on a software system that they considered had a good software architecture? Show of hands. Yeah? Now, well, keep them up. Look around the room, folks. Look around the room. I count about a dozen hands, from what I can see, have worked on a software architecture. A dozen hands out of several hundred people. That in of itself is a damning statistic of our industry, that we're all of us feeling like we get it that wrong on such a regular basis. But the next question that comes out of this frequently is to say, what made that architecture good? When I've done this talk, I've asked people in the audience when I've had a little bit more time, what exactly made it good? People will say, oh, well, it was really simple. It was really easy for me to understand. Or some people would say it was really elegant in terms of the problem that it solved. Or it was really particular tuned to the problem that we were trying to solve. That ultimately gets to the point where we want to be, which is to say architectures live inside a particular context. If we talk about the architecture to an online game like World of Warcraft, the architecture there is going to be very, very different from what we might see for something like Uber or Yelp or Amazon. Does that mean that World of Warcraft has a great architecture and Uber and Yelp don't? Does that mean that Uber and Yelp have a good architecture and World of Warcraft doesn't? No. What it means is that in each case, the architecture was specific to the problem that it was trying to solve. There are all of these, what some people refer to as non-functional requirements. I don't particularly care for that phrase, because if you have a banking application, and if the banking application has not chosen to maximize the lever on security, I would call that non-functional, because if somebody can mimic my password, if somebody can intercept the token, conduct a man-on-the-middle attack, and somehow obtain access to my bank account, that's not functional, regardless of whatever features that they actually managed to make work. Yes, I'm looking at you, Chase Bank. One of the things that we as architects try to do, there was a gentleman at Microsoft, gentleman by the name of Rico Mariani. He was a Visual Studio performance architect. One of the things Rico liked to toss off as a phrase, as he said, as architects, we want to enable developers to fall naturally into the pit of success. If you do nothing but simply follow the direction that the architecture guides you, you will fall naturally into a place where you are successful. Correctness by default. That's a good definition. I like that. But it still doesn't really get us to the answer of what exactly is a good architecture. Good architecture, any architecture, will give us the appropriate levels of integrity, simplicity, modularity, reliability, recoverability, all of those itties. It'll give us good amounts of that. But what exactly is an architecture? It's a set of answers. See, every day when a developer comes into work and they look at their backlog and they look at the stories that they have to work on, they say, oh, I have to actually calculate the sales tax on this bundle of goods for this particular e-commerce portal that I'm working on. So what I need to do, first of all, is I need to figure out where is the bundle of goods. Is that stored in session, or is that something I have to slurp out of the database? And if it's in the database, do I have to create my own connection to the database? And if so, where do I get the credentials for that? And once I have that connection, when I'm finished with it, Do I close that connection, or do I just let go of my reference to it so it can return to the pool? Once I have the data that I'm interested in, that is to say the bundle of goods, now I need to know where it's getting shipped to. Is that somewhere in memory already, or again, do I have to go get that from a database, or is that included as a part of the bundle of goods that I obtained? Is that a part of the order object? All of these questions are questions that developers will ask on a daily basis. Now, let's be really clear about something. Developers, i.e. you and me, we will do the simplest possible thing that could possibly work. We will take the easiest path, because unless we have a reason not to, why wouldn't we? Think about that. And this is how you end up with a web application that on a given user request opens up 17 database connections and makes 25 web service calls and ends up taking 4 days in order to respond to that single user request. Because in each case, the developer did what was best for that individual developer. The so-called tragedy of the commons. The architect is the one who answers those questions by saying, nope, don't open your own connection. Here is a connection pool. Grab one from there. Nope, don't make a web request directly. Put what you want done into this local queue, and we'll send that off on some sort of asynchronous invocation pattern. Go ahead and obtain the data that you're looking for directly from the tables in question, but go ahead and fetch all of that data at once rather than getting it in multiple round trips, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. A software architecture at its heart is simply a set of answers to the questions that developers will ask on a daily basis. That's it. Everything else is window dressing. Everything else is trying to make it easier for those questions to be answered. Now, what defines those things? Well, how do I create those questions? How do I answer those questions? In many cases, it's not that I want to create a frequently asked questions list. An architecture isn't just a fact. I want to make sure that the developers can sort of ingest it. I want to make sure that they can understand it deeply, inside their bones. Ideally, every developer on a project, on demand, should be able to walk over to a whiteboard and sketch out the architecture of this project, so that every developer can see how they fit inside the larger realm of things. So they can see that they are one part of this incoming user request, or that they are responsible for the entire user request response cycle, or whatever happens to be appropriate for the application that you're building. Developers need to know the context in which they live. So we don't want to just have 15,000 different frequently asked question answers and expect them to remember them all. As a matter of fact, psychology tells us that we will actually only really be able to remember that mythical 3 to 7 range. You can remember 5 things, plus or minus 2. So ideally, what I want to do is I want to provide some heuristics. I want to provide some guides. But here's the funny thing. Every time you try to create an architecture that is ironclad, that says, thou shalt always do this, inevitably you run into a situation where doing that is actually probably the wrong thing. Back in the earliest days of the J2EE discussions, right, back in the early days of EJB and so forth, the Sun guys produced this architectural blueprints diagram that described how your requests would go from the browser into the application server, which would then go talk to the database. The interesting thing was, it took a couple of revs, but eventually we saw a line go directly from the web server to the database, what they called the fast lane pattern, because occasionally it was actually much faster for you to just go directly to the database rather than hopping through the application server, all of the supposed caching notwithstanding. See, an architecture can't be always prescriptive, because otherwise you're asking me, the architect, to anticipate every possible situation and come up with a scenario that would deal with every possible situation. So an architecture can't be an ironclad, steel handcuffs, you must do it this way, unless you're German. Germans maybe can get away with that, but the rest of us can't. They need to be guides. They need to be signposts. They need to be recommendations. 80 to 90% of the time, it's okay to do this. But if the circumstances warrant and you need to sneak around this way, that's okay too. This, by the way, is why the architect needs to be actually a coder, a developer on the project, because the architect won't be able to see those weird edge cases that come up. And if the weird edge cases start to outnumber the normal cases, that's a sign to the architect that she needs to rethink what it is that she's established and possibly needs to refactor the architecture a little bit. All of this comes to mind the idea of what the business folks refer to as strategy. You may think it rather odd that at a technical conference, somebody would start talking about, you know, the business folks, the MBAs, not making fun of them. But in this particular case, when you start reading about MBAs and you start reading about what they think about in terms of strategy, the core of strategy work is always the same: discovering the critical factors in a situation and designing a way of coordinating and focusing actions to deal with those factors. What do architects do? We sit, we study, we ask questions, we figure out what the business wants. We want to understand the factors that are involved in this particular application or this particular system. A good strategy honestly acknowledges the challenges being faced and provides an approach to overcoming them. That's exactly what I've just been talking about. A good architecture honestly confronts the challenges that are in play. We need to be able to scale to 1 million transactions a day, says Jeff Bezos. And therefore, we need to think about what that means. We need to understand what that scalability will entail. We need to make sure that we are minimizing the amount of time that we are spending waiting. We need to minimize lock windows and so forth. We need to actually get rid of the distributed two-phase transactions as a part of our application across multiple databases, and we need to come up with a different sort of concurrency mechanism because we are in a context where we have to think about those things. Meanwhile, as you go back to the office and your office asks you to build an application for tracking, I don't know, vacation requests, and there's 250 people in your company, do you have the same situation? Do you face the same challenges as the folks at Amazon? Oh, heavens no. 250 people at most using your application versus literally potentially millions of transactions a day. Those are two very, very different sets of challenges. We need to honestly approach that. Yeah, it would be great if someday your company had millions of people in it and your vacation system was what they all used to place their PTO requests. When that time comes, we'll deal with it. One of the things that the business folks have started to discover is that if you can phrase things in the terms of what we call simple rules. Southwest Airlines, for example, when they talk about how they deal with their doing business, one of their first simple rules is always err on the side of the customer. This is why you'll hear stories about Southwest flight attendants when they discover that somebody's precious stuffed animal has been left on board a flight. The flight attendant figures out who that family was sitting in that seat. Then they go and they figure out, okay, where are they going to next? And then the flight attendant goes over to the aircraft that's flying to their next destination and talks to the pilot and crew on that other flight and then actually takes pictures of the bear sitting in a chair and tweets it out so that people can know that the bear will meet them at their destination, because the CEO of Southwest Airlines has said, if you do something that is pro-customer, I have your back. That's a very simple rule. And it's earned Southwest Airlines all kinds of positive publicity. They don't drag people kicking and screaming off of aircraft. Yes, I'm looking at you, United Airlines. When business folks talk about corporate strategies, when they talk about corporate culture, when they talk about corporate visions, et cetera, they love to use the dime store words. We seek to leverage the synergies of positive energies in order to facilitate. And you're like, what are you saying? You have literally strung random words together. Scott Adams, The guy that created Dilbert actually has a random mission statement generator. And there are stories of people who have used that and submitted it as the company's mission statement and been accepted. That's not what we're talking about here. When we talk about simple rules, we are talking about decision-making tools, heuristics, that are designed to govern behavior, and they generally express some notion of intent and direction. This is where we want to go. If you must do data access, do it through the data layer that we have created. That's not a hard and fast rule. That's a heuristic. That's a simple rule. Use the data layer to access the database. Use the data layer to access all of the databases. If we have multiple databases, always go through our data layer rather than spinning up your own connection. Or perhaps, if you must obtain some data, go through our caching layer first. In other words, let the caching layer manage obtaining data from the data layer so that if the cache has a copy of it handy, you can use the cached copy rather than going directly to the data layer. Or whatever. Rules should be simple. They should be straightforward. They should be relatively easy to remember, and ideally there won't be more than three to seven of them. That 5 ±2. Simple Rules is a book, by the way, the authors were on the previous slide, tailored specifically to the problem at hand. In other words, your architecture. Apply to well-defined activity or decisions, that is to say, the things that you are working on as you build the software. Provide clear guidance, but allow for deviation. When you create these rules, when you create these guidelines, you are providing extremely clear answers to the developers so that they can know, oh, what I need to do when I calculate the sales tax on this bundle of goods, I need to, A, follow the rule that says where I get the data from, B, I need to make sure that all of my calculations are done in parallel where possible, whatever the rule set you choose to make. Which then leaves us with the question, what is the architect? Well, I mean, on the one hand, the architect is the guy that comes up with all of this, guy or girl. But there are 4 things in particular architects must do. The first, the architect has to understand. I don't mean understand the technology. That's part of it, but the bigger thing is the architect has to understand the domain. What are you trying to build? Why are we building this? What's the goal? What do we really want out of this application? And we have to understand the context of this application. When is it due? Like, how quickly do we want to have this thing? And in some cases, bear in mind that the customer may not know some of these answers, and it's still on you to find them out, but you're hopefully going to find them out in conjunction with your customer. They're going to say, well, I think we can have this ready, like you know, in terms of the executive board and everybody, their expectations, I think if we have this ready in 6 months, we're good to go. Your next question should be, okay, but who would actually make the decision on that? Do we have the power to say when we're going to be done, or are we going to be held to somebody else's expectations regarding deadline? Who is going to make the call on that? Because if we think we have 6 months and the executive board thinks we have 3, we have a problem. We have almost as much of a problem if we think we have 6 months and they think we have 9, because they probably have greater expectations for what we're going to deliver. And God help us if we actually meet all of those expectations in 6 rather than 9, because now they're going to say, you guys are amazing. We're slashing all of your deadlines by 2/3. There is such a thing as being too good at your job. Just saying. The architect needs to understand the goals. The architect needs to understand the constraints. Because those constraints, actually, little secret here, constraints are liberating. Constraints actually make your job easier, believe it or not. Fred Brooks, the guy who described Mythical Man Month back in the day, right, talking about software in terms of 9 women having 1 baby in 1 month, all of that stuff. Fred Brooks came out with a new book a couple of years ago in which he called The Design of Design. How do we get good designers practice design? Well, inside of that, he's talking about the constraints around design. And if I were to walk up to any one of you and I were to say, build me a web app. That's all I give you. Build me a web app. What technology do you use? How long will it take you? What database do you use? A lot of you will go to your standby. You like, you know, you like Ruby on Rails, or you like, you know, the old Java EE architecture, or you happen to be a fan of .NET or whatever. But you're going to feel this strange sense to your insides going, but how do I know this is what they really want? We actually operate better with constraints. There is a great story talking about a group of open source developers that were asked to build a personal information system. Basically, it was supposed to be an Outlook killer. And they were given unlimited time and unlimited budget. 3 years later, as the book was going to press, they still had not shipped. This is the so-called Chandler project. And it finally did ship about a year after the book was published. And of course, the book's title is escaping me at the moment. But the Chandler project finally did ship, and the 17 people that used it thought it was great, and then it disappeared into obscurity. They completely re-engineered their persistence layer 3 times. They chose different programming languages 2x. It was literally a software developer's Stephen King novel. Because you knew, as you're reading this book, I think, Dreaming in Code, that was the name of the book. As you're reading this, you're reading and you're saying, okay, all right, so now getting some momentum here, we're going to build some projects, build some components, this is good. Oh, God, they've got a meeting. No, don't go to the meeting. Don't go to the meeting. I know what's going to, don't go to, oh, shit, they went to the meeting. Oh, crap. They named a new chief architect. Oh, he's going to choose all different technology. Damn it, I've lived this. Constraints are liberating. But part of the thing that you have to understand is the world doesn't stand still. The business changes. This is one of the things that software folks don't seem to want to really accept in many respects. The business world changes. We want to work on a given thing. We want to say, all right, you tell me what you want, and you give me like 6 months, and I'll build that thing. And we want the rest of the world to basically hold still while we finish delivering the thing that they've asked us to deliver. The world don't work that way. Many of you who flew here boarded your aircraft using nothing more than your cell phone. Back in my day, you see the gray in my beard here? I'm old. I remember when you couldn't get on board an aircraft without having a physical piece of paper in your hand. As a matter of fact, not just any paper, it had to be one of those little card things that they print there at the airport. You walked up to the counter, you provided your government-issued identification, they chunk, something came out, they gave you those, it was often stapled together with your bag tags, if you checked any bags, and then you had to have those, and they actually tore off the ends as you got on board the aircraft. And then one day, somebody said, wait a minute, why does it have to be our paper? Why can't it be somebody else's paper? And somebody said, well, we have to check their IDs. They said, okay, but the IDs are something that we could verify electronic, right? Why do they have to like physically walk up to a human? Shortly thereafter, the first kiosks at the airport showed up. I think it was Southwest did that first. I can't remember. Now I don't have to go stand in line to talk to somebody. I can just walk up to the kiosk, show it my ID, boom, out comes the printed card. And then somebody said, okay, about that paper thing, why does it have to be that paper? Can't we check their ID? I mean, we are going to check their ID at the security station. Do we even need to check the ID to give them the boarding pass? And they said, no, I don't think so. Next thing you know, websites emerged. Now, bear in mind, this was not on the radar of any software developer at any airline until that first kiosk showed up. And then all of a sudden, that went from a competitive advantage in the airline industry to an absolute necessity. The first 2 companies that implement an innovation, they get to call it a competitive advantage. Everybody else has to do it to catch up just to maintain parity. This is a standard facet of business. If you don't like this, I don't know what you do. I mean, I don't know where you go. I don't know who you work for, because there you go. Go work for the government. Because governments never change, right? Governments never, ever, ever change. You would never have a president come in and completely undo everything the previous president has done. That's just not done. The other thing you need to do, though, is you need to explore. I don't have to tell you this. You're here. You're at this conference. You are here literally to be introduced to things that you don't already know. So you're already one of these things up. Even if you're not formally an architect, you're already looking at these technologies. You're looking at what's out there. You're looking at what's available. And in the back of your mind, you're going to be thinking, is this something we should think about bringing back to the company? Is this just kind of cool? Or is it something that we should use? Or is it something we should at least look into, because I can't tell if this is be something that's good for us or not? You're already doing this exploration. Yay, good for you. But the last thing you need, if you're going to be an architect, you need to lead. You cannot be an architect sitting back in your chair saying, yeah, I think maybe someday we should do this functional programming thing. Looks like it might actually be big, might be useful. That's not architecting. That's just commenting. You're just somebody's, like, you know, uncle, stretched out in his Barca lounger with a can of beer watching the game on TV. You're not going to follow that guy. Because part of leadership means planting a flag in the ground and saying, donk, I believe that we should, in fact, embrace Vue.js for our Vue layer, because I've thought about it, and here are the pros and here are the cons. And the pros work well for us, and the cons don't really apply to us. And by the way, every technology ever has pros and cons. If you go talk to somebody at this conference and you ask them, what's the drawback to using your thing? What's the drawback to the thing that you're talking about up here on stage? And they can't answer you, then they don't know it very well. Sorry, speakers, I got to set you up for this. You have to be able to describe when not to use a given thing, because nothing is one size fits all. As an architect, you have to be willing to make a decision. You have to be willing to put your credibility on the line to say, yeah, this is, I think, where we go. And if you're wrong, okay, you're wrong. No, seriously, you're wrong, you're wrong. Nobody's perfect all of the time. Not even me. Who's laughing? You need to be able to place that stake in the ground. You need to be able to say, we should do this so that your team can benefit, because you have that vision, you've seen those things, you understand the goals of the company, etc. You need to be able to lead. In many respects, this does not sound like the guy that just sits in his office drawing up pictures. What it really sounds like, what it really, really sounds like, it's a band. It's a symphony, an orchestra. The guy at the front of the room waving the stick. See, the funny thing about that conductor is he's not the best trombone player in the band. He's not the best bassoonist. He's not the best violinist. He's not the best flautist. But he sees the entire band. He sees the entire orchestra. He has a vision for how we're going to present this piece. And he coordinates the various groups to come together so that each group can do what they do, do it to the best of their ability. And he simply welds that together into something that's more than the sum of its parts. When you start looking at some of the definitions of the conductor, directs rehearsals and performances, shapes the musical interpretation. This is the vision that I have. Has to communicate that frequently by doing so through the rehearsals and performances. Has many specific responsibilities, accuracy, ensemble, tempo, blah, blah, blah. The architect is very similar to this. I don't have to be the best JavaScript programmer on the team. I just have to understand how JavaScript applies best to our project. I don't have to be the best relational database architect, as long as I understand enough of the relational database to know what it does well and what it does not do well. And sometimes you don't have a conductor because the band is small enough. If you've got a modern rock band of, say, four or five people, you generally don't have somebody up at the front waving a stick. That would look rather weird. But if you look at the band's dynamics, they each of them take that architect role. The drummer, for example, will frequently set the tempo for the piece. There will be somebody in the band who's considered the leader that decides what our set is going to consist of. Each of the members of the band can sometimes take turns performing various things. I may have some lyrics that I've written for this piece that I want us to perform. And the other guy may have a good, a good tune. He's got some good melody and harmonics, but he doesn't have good lyrics. We can weld those two together and create a piece. And sometimes the band's manager decides which pieces they play, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. Now, at some point, we start to disagree on who exactly the leader of the band is. And the nice thing about that is now we have two bands. Right? A small development team doesn't always have to explicitly have an architect, as long as we understand what that role is and we can all feel comfortable taking turns, establishing, providing those same kinds of answers and guidance to the rest of the group. The other thing that you can often see sort of in line with the conductor is that of a director of a movie or stage production, right? It's very, very similar kinds of roles. The effect is basically the same. We want to direct everybody in the right direction. So what are we left with? Architecture, it's just a set of answers. That's it. How you communicate those answers, that's up to you. PowerPoint, Visio, you want to walk up to a whiteboard, you want to draw a big picture on large sheets of butcher paper, whatever, I don't care. As long as those answers get communicated. The architect is somebody responsible for divining those answers and communicating those answers. The end. It's that simple. Peace.
Now we have a coffee break and then we have a split. So please check a schedule and conference is continuous.